Penguin Random House Audio presents Burning Bright by Nick Petrie, read for you by Stephen Mendel. In what distant deeps or skies burnt the fire of thine eyes? On what wings dare he aspire? What the hand dare seize the fire? Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forests of the night, what immortal hand or eye dare frame thy fearful symmetry? William Blake. Prologue. Don't get in the car. June Cassidy had heard this many times. From her mom, from her self-defense instructors, from her friends, the same thing over and over. No matter what, don't get in the car, because then they have you. It was good advice, she thought, but it did her no good now that they'd gotten her in the fucking car. She had her back against the locked door of a big SUV, plastic handcuffs on her wrists, and a witless slab of pseudo-government beef leering at her from the next seat over. Her options were limited. June was having a particularly bad week in a challenging few years. Her newspaper got bought out just like practically every other big city paper, and the new owners loaded it up with debt to pay themselves for their investment. When the classifieds plummeted like a rock, thanks, Craig, for your free fucking list, the paper began to lay off reporters, especially investigative reporters, who might take weeks or months to research a story for publication. June was young, cheap labor, and she was good at her job, so she lasted longer than most. But the economics were brutal and getting more unforgiving by the minute. Then the axe finally fell, and June was just another freelancer with a degree in journalism. In this age of technology, it was almost as useful as a degree in Klingon or, God forbid, English. For a woman on her own and pushing 30, freelancing was no substitute for an actual job. Somehow, after a year of scrounging for scraps and trying to learn how to drive traffic to her blog, she'd gotten invited to join Public Investigations, a non-profit group of investigative journalists funded by a Kickstarter-like model dedicated to doing the kind of work that many papers could no longer afford to pay for. Public Investigations did awesome work. Their financial reporters broke the in-depth story about the attempted bank bombing in Milwaukee and the flash crash that went with it. But the budget was small, and June was still essentially a freelancer with editorial backup, which was not the same thing as health insurance and a byline in the Chicago Tribune. Still, she was making real progress, splitting time between her garage apartment in Seattle and her mom's little house in Palo Alto, which gave her an inexpensive platform to cover the West Coast. Her specialty was issues of privacy in the electronic age. After Manning and Snowden and the NSA revelations, privacy seemed permanently in the headlines, and her professional life was finally taking off again. Then her mom, a yoga fanatic and vegetarian who also swam a half mile every day, was killed by a hit-and-run driver and died a week ago today. June's mother, Hazel Cassidy, tenured professor at Stanford University, MacArthur Genius Grant winner, and renowned pain in the ass, killed by a plumber's truck at 60. Like a lot of women, June had a complicated relationship with her mother. June's career choices, her boyfriends, her hair, all were candidates for improvement, although her mother never made a direct assault. Hazel's trademark was a certain kind of passive-aggressive backhanded compliment. "That outfit wouldn't work on me, but it looks very nice on you." When June's investigative series on data breaches in medical technology was nominated for the Pulitzer, Hazel threw her daughter a fabulous party, but also invited June's ex-boyfriend because June's current flame didn't meet Hazel's high standards. The worst of it, of course, was that she was usually right. She was right about the outfit, and she was right about the fucking boyfriend, too. About all the boyfriends, actually. June tried, sometimes successfully, not to be so stubborn that she couldn't recognize how well her mother knew her and how much she cared. It was easier now that her mother was dead. What June wouldn't give for another snarky comment about her goddamn hair. Her mom had been gone a week, and it already felt like forever. June had spent the first few days planning and surviving the memorial service, and the days after in her mother's house, going through her things, crying and remembering, and trying to figure things out. Not least of which was the fact that her mother had apparently been working on some kind of classified software project for the Department of Defense, and she'd never even hinted at it to June. Unable to sleep, June had planned to use her mother's key card and code to let herself into the cluttered lab at Stanford. She told herself she was there to collect family pictures and the few plants her mother had managed not to kill, but mostly she just wanted to sit with the memory of her mom in the place she'd most fully inhabited, her computer lab. Instead, June found a broken lock, the door held open by a chair, and a pair of thick, humorless men in dark suits with Defense Department IDs packing Tiger, her mother's experimental bench-made mini supercomputer, into a cardboard box with all the spare drives they could find. They'd already stacked their hand truck with banker's boxes, apparently filled with the contents of her mother's secure, fireproof file cabinet, which now stood open like a corpse for the medical examiner. Although the G-men didn't show their IDs long enough for her to get their names, they made sure June could see the guns on their hips. The pale one did the talking while his eyes wandered up and down her body. The dark one didn't say a word. They left her standing in the doorway with a warning that even this incident was classified, and if she even spoke of it, she would face federal prosecution. June watched them trundle the hand truck down the hall, thinking that her mother had always hated the government. So why would she work for the Department of Defense? Put another way, why would they show up at 3 a.m.? And why would they take Tiger, the temperamental mini super, but leave the big, blazing fast, liquid-cooled Cray her mother had been so proud of? So June had a lot on her mind, and when she finally dragged her ass out of bed the next day, she realized there was no coffee in the house. How the hell had that happened? When she recognized the emergency conditions, she pulled on yesterday's clothes, slung her messenger bag over her shoulder, got on her mother's ancient but highly tuned single-speed Schwinn, and headed for Phil's coffee. On Middlefield Road, a giant black SUV with tinted windows pulled up beside her, crowding her toward the parking lane. Red and blue lights flashed on the dash. When the passenger window hummed down, the same pale, humorless G-man from the night before pretended to smile at her now. He wasn't looking at her face, of course. He was watching the way the cross strap from her messenger bag defined her breasts. Definitely not cool, she thought. Some woman needs to rewrite the DOD training manual. "Please pull over, Miss Cassidy. We'd like to speak with you for a few moments." "Not right now," June said crossly, still pedaling. She was dangerously under-caffeinated, with a headache that would kill a rhino, and hadn't done shit for exercise in several days. The bike ride was just beginning to unknot her muscles when this moron showed up. "I need some coffee." The big SUV kept pace with her. "This will just take a moment," he said. "We can drive through Starbucks if you'd like." The G-man clearly failed to comprehend. Plus, she would never go to Starbucks unless she was taken hostage, and even then she would fight it. "Hey," she said, "I'm busy. Send me an email. Call my cell. I'm sure you can figure out the number." The G-man looked at the driver, who was definitely less pale but appeared no less humorless. Why did they have such horrible suits? The driver nodded. "Ma'am," said the pale G-man, "I'm with the United States government. Are you refusing my lawful request?" Jesus Christ, no! Although she was starting to wonder if it was a lawful request. This wasn't her area, but she could make some calls and find out. "After lunch, okay? I have a meeting. Send me a text." The G-man raised his hand, and the driver slanted the black SUV into her path, leaving June no option but to slam on the brakes or be forced into a parked car. "Hey, listen, motherfucker," she began, but the G-man stepped out of the SUV, jammed a crackling electric stun gun into her side, and pulled the trigger. It felt like being punched by a gorilla. June's legs stopped working, and she collapsed over her mom's bike. The man captured her wrists in a pair of plastic riot handcuffs disentangled her from the Schwinn, picked her up like a rag doll, and threw her into the back seat. The driver scanned his mirrors. What about the bike? Leave it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.